Ladies and gentlemen, live before a recorded audience, hey, hey, it's Darrel and Ozzie. And now, here's Darrel.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Nice to say thank you, thank you. Stop.
And welcome. Ozzie, what are you doing over there?
I'm just playing between the tracks of the record.
Well, you shouldn't play between the tracks because you know what might happen.
No, what? Gee, that was close.
I want to tell you a story of true fame and glory about a donkey I know. Hey, hey, I say, we're down in old Mexico. Hey, hey, I say, he's with the traveling show. Oh, oh well, he plays in the band, does an old song and dance, and he's a forever playing the fool.
Forever playing,
I say, and though he's only a mule,
and though he's only
I say,
a mule,
he never loses his cool. Come on, Pedro, show me how you play. Come on, Pedro, show me how you play. You know the Pedro, the donkey, plays real honky-tonky and the old piano roll blues. Hey, hey, I say, he'll play whatever you choose. Hey, hey, I say, he's guaranteed to amuse.
Well, here I am to tell Ozzie a story, but he's not here.
Daryl!
Ah, here he comes now.
Here comes Ozzie, Ostrich. What a cheeky bird, a sticky, beaky bird. Hello, Ozzie, Ostrich. You're a dilly bird, a silly, billy bird. We can see you when you hide. Your head's in the sand, but your rest is outside. You're a thunderhead, old friend of mine. Let's see what you messed up this time.
Oh, what are you doing down there?
Up.
Oh, no wonder you fell over wearing those great big boots. Now sit over there and I'll tell you a story.
But why can't I sit here and look over your shoulder?
No, it's rude to look over people's shoulders when they're reading. Now sit over there and be good.
Oh, all right.
I don't know.
Okay, go ahead with the story.
Right. Once upon a time...
Oh, I've heard it before.
Ozzie, come back here. All fairy tales start with once upon a time.
Well, why don't they start with twice upon a time?
Well, I don't know.
Well?
Oh, all right. Twice upon a time, there lived three bears. Their names were...
Teddy, Humphrey and Yogi.
No.
Minnie, Binnie and Skinny?
No.
Patty, Hattie and Fatty?
No, definitely not. First, there was Father Bear. Then came Mother Bear, and she had...
A little bear behind?
A little bear behind. No. Well, yes, well, it was Baby Bear.
Oh.
They were sitting down to breakfast when Father Bear tried his porridge and said...
This porridge tastes like wash-up water, and Mother Bear said, it isn't really, it's the water I soaked your socks in, and Father Bear said...
Don't be disgusting.
Yes, how did you know?
No, he didn't... Oh. Father Bear said, this porridge is hot.
Gosh, stolen porridge.
No, when he said hot, he didn't mean hot. I'll skip it.
Oh, yeah, let's skip the porridge and I'll have bacon and eggs.
No one is having bacon and eggs.
Oh, good. All the more for me.
Look, let's get back to the story. Father Bear said, let's go for a walk while our porridge cools off.
What a good idea. The fool that takes him for an idiot's no drongo.
Just as soon as they were gone... Guess who came to the door?
I know. The Avon lady.
No, not the Avon lady.
Oh, that's good. The bell's busted anyway.
What are you doing over here?
I just wanted to look at the pictures.
There are no pictures. Now go back to your seat and I'll continue.
Oh, gee.
Goodness.
Okay, off you go.
No sooner were the three bears over the hill than Goldilocks came along.
Was she over the hill?
No, she was a little girl who'd been lost in the woods all night.
What a lucky night to be lost in the woods.
Why?
Well, the wolf was over at Grandma's house hiding in the cupboard.
Oh, but look, that's another story. Oh. And this was another part of the woods. Sort of thick and dense.
Like your head.
Like my head. No. Oh. Look, will you please stop interrupting? Goldilocks looked through the window and saw steaming hot porridge on the table. She was so hungry that she ran inside, sat down in Father Bear's chair and tried his porridge. But it was far too hot, so what did she do?
She put it in the fridge.
No, she left that plate and she sat down in...
Mother Bear's porridge?
No. She tasted Mother Bear's porridge, but it was too hot, so...
So she ran to the phone and called Dial a Cornflake.
She did not. She moved to the next little chair, which was Baby Bear's, and she sat down. But the baby chair broke into pieces.
Oh, never mind. There was a hole in it anyway.
Then she tried the porridge, and it was just right. So she ate it all up.
Greedy.
And when she had eaten the porridge, she was very tired.
How come she was so tired? You don't have to chew porridge.
But she'd been lost in the woods all night.
Oh, yes, and the motels were full.
No, yeah, well, oh, look, we won't go into that.
Goldilocks didn't either.
What?
Going to the motel.
Look, let's get back to the story, please.
All right.
Goldilocks went upstairs.
Upstairs? How about those bears?
What do you mean?
Well, they live in a two-story house, and all I have is a lousy bucket of sand.
Look, that remark is irresponsible, totally irrelevant, and wholly inconsequential.
That's easy for you to say.
You want a bet? Goldilocks tried Father Bear's bed, but it was too hard.
No wonder. Bears sleep in logs.
Yes, but these bears sleep in beds.
Oh.
She tried Mother Bear's bed, but it was too soft. So she thought...
I should have stayed at the motel.
Will you be quiet? How do you expect me to tell you the story when you keep interrupting like that?
Sorry.
Now, she thought, I'll try the little bed. So she tried Baby Bear's bed, and it...
Smashed the pieces?
No, it was just right. And in no time, she was fast asleep.
Well, that was a nice story. Thank you very much, Darrel.
Well, thank you, Ossie. My pleasure.
It's nice to say thank you. Thank you, Darrel.
Thank you, Ossie.
Thank you, Darrel.
Just a minute. Look, I haven't finished, thank you.
Oh, thank you, Darrel.
Look, will you go back to your seat, please, until I finish?
Oh, gee.
Oh. Now, are you completely ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. Okay, go
All
ahead.
All right. No sooner had Goldilocks gone to sleep than the three bears came home.
Wow, the thought plickens.
You mean the plot thickens.
That's what I said, did I?
Anyway, Father Bear looked at his plate and said, someone's been eating my porridge.
Goldilocks must have forgotten to lick the spoon.
Mother Bear said, someone has been eating my porridge.
She must have dribbled a bit too.
And then Baby Bear said, someone has been eating my porridge and it's all gone. And then he began to cry.
She'd pinched his chewy from under the table.
Father Bear was very angry and he decided to go upstairs and look round.
But he looks round already.
When I say look round, I don't mean look round, I mean look round.
Oh, I get it. When you say look round, you don't mean look round, you mean look round.
Exactly.
I think he's a rat bear.
So off they went, upstairs.
Goldilocks is up there asleep.
Yes, and Father Bear took one look at his bed and he knew that someone had been in it.
A pair of elephant's pajamas on the pillow.
There was nothing of the sort.
Ah.
Then Mother Bear said, someone has been sleeping in my bed.
Uh-oh, here it comes.
Just then, Baby Bear said...
Well, good night, everybody.
No, he said, someone's in my bed now, fast asleep. Suddenly, Goldilocks woke up and saw the three bears. She got such a fright that she jumped out the window and ran through the woods all the way home. And that ends the story of Goldilocks and the three bears.
Didn't the wolf chase her through the woods?
No, I told you before, that's another story.
But didn't she get to cut down the beanstalk?
No, you've got it all wrong.
But didn't the witch give her a poisoned apple?
No, you're way out there.
Oh.
And speaking of being way out, what about those great heavy boots you're wearing?
What do you mean, boots? They're in fashion.
Oh.
Haven't you ever heard of Puss in Boots?
What about him?
Well, I'll tell you. Once upon a time...
Oh, I've heard it before.
He's gone. What a strange person.
Oz,
yeah?
Have you ever thought about what you want to be when you grow up?
Oh, yes.
What's that?
An ostrich.
Yes, but I mean professionally. I mean, would you like to be an artist?
No.
Or a doctor?
Uh-uh.
Or perhaps a fireman?
No.
Well, what would you like to be?
Well, I think I want to be an engineer.
I want to be an engineer, my friend. I want to be an engineer. I'm gonna be an engineer, my friend. I'm gonna be an engineer.
I'm speaking to an engineer who has just built a great bridge across the Amazon River. I suppose you're very proud of it.
Not really. It was supposed to be across the Murrumbidgee.
Which building method did you use?
Oh, the conventional method. You see, the idea is to start building on both sides of the river.
I see.
And meet in the middle.
Yes, well then, why do I see two bridges?
We missed.
I suppose you have a name for your bridges.
Yes, I call them jeans.
Not your trousers. I mean, what have you called your two bridges?
Oh, I've called them Lloyd Bridges.
But isn't Lloyd Bridges mostly underwater?
Yes, and so are my bridges.
I'll never be an engineer, my friend.
I'll never be an engineer. Hi, just had an idea. What about newsreader?
A newsreader?
Yes.
I want to be a newsreader, friend. I want to read the news so well. I'm gonna be a newsreader, friend. I'm gonna read that news so well.
Here is the news. A Melbourne surgeon has transplanted a private detective's ear to his navel. The detective wanted to listen at keyholes without bending down.
Meanwhile, in Sydney, a surgeon has transplanted an extra hand onto a garbage man's head so he can hold his nose while he empties the tins.
An 8-year-old boy has been found in the Australian bush. He was lost as a baby and was brought up by two kangaroos. Reunited with his real mother, he spent the first week sitting in her apron pocket. He says he likes living in a house, but he keeps bumping his head on the ceiling.
Sir Hugh McBite, the famous animal trainer, is reported to be missing.
No.
Yes. His pet alligator was tight-lipped about the matter and seemed to have a lump in his throat.
Mm.
Mrs. McBite said once before her husband had thrown meat to his alligators and forgotten to let go. She refused to speak to the alligator about the matter, saying that she prefers to wait until he brings it up in the conversation. When interviewed by our reporter, the alligator had this to say.
I'll never be a newsreader, friend.
I don't read the news so well. Hey, just thought of something else. What about deep sea diver?
Oh, you make up your mind.
I want to be a deep sea diver, friend. I want to dive so deep below. I'm gonna be a deep sea diver, friend. I'm gonna dive so deep below.
Hello down there. Are you a diver?
Of course I'm a diver. What did you think I was, a sardine?
Well, no.
How do you do?
What on earth are you doing down there?
Shaking hands with an octopus.
Don't be ridiculous. Can you see anything?
Yes. Tell me, what lies on the bottom of the sea and quivers?
Oh, I don't know. What lies on the bottom of the sea and quivers?
A nervous wreck.
Very funny. But what's the water like?
Just a minute.
Oh, goodness. He's in trouble. I'll have to pull him up. Here we go. What happened? What happened? Pull yourself together, man. What happened?
Oh, you asked me what the water was like, so I took my helmet off to have a look.
Beat, bird brain. You let the water into your suit.
I suppose you're angry with me now.
Yes, and you know what that means.
Yes, you won't let me dive in your bath again.
I'll never be a deep sea diver, friend.
That's another thing I don't do well. I've got it!
Oh, really?
estate agent friend have flats to rent or sell. I'm gonna be an estate agent friend, have flats to rent or sell.
Oh, good morning. Acme Estate Agents?
Yep.
Oh, I believe you have a flat to rent.
Yes, sir. I have a fine little flat just around the corner.
Oh, gee, that's handy. Has it hot and cold running water?
Yes, sir. Down the walls.
Oh, dear me. Does it have an electric stove?
Certainly, sir. But there is just one little problem.
What's that?
If you cook a roast, you have to change the batteries 3 times.
Gee. I'm looking for something with ankle-deep carpet.
Oh, well, this flat has ankle-deep carpet, sir. And I mean ankle-deep when you're standing on your head.
Remarkable.
Yeah, the last tenant didn't leave. He's still lost in the carpet.
Oh, what about heating?
Well, the heating is just great, sir, just great. Every 5 minutes, a duck blows hot air into the middle of the room.
A duck? Whatever for?
Well, surely you've heard of ducted central heating.
I'll never be an estate agent friend.
There's a lot of things I don't do well.
You can say that again.
Don't want to be an engineer, my friend. Don't want to be a newsreader, friend. Don't want to be a deep-sea diver, friend. Don't want to be an estate agent, friend.
Daryl?
Yes?
I don't know what I want to be when I grow up.
Oh, great fella twit. Well, Ozzie, our jungle safari is going well. We've landed our aircraft in the centre of a tropical jungle.
Yes, I've never seen such thick jungle.
Yes, we've been chopping through it for hours.
And we're not out of the plane yet.
Oh, don't be silly.
Oh, look at those tropical vines.
Yes, what attractive flowers.
And I think they like us.
Why?
They're putting their arms around us.
No! I should have known. This jungle is famous for its man-eating plants.
Oh, well, let the man eat what he likes.
No, you don't understand. It's a plant that eats men.
Oh.
And it has its tentacles around us.
Oh, and they're getting tighter and tighter.
Ossie, old pal, I think it's my end.
It's got me by the end, too.
We're finished, Ossie. Oh, that it should happen like this.
Oh.
Out here in the jungle, alone and forgotten.
Yes, we didn't even get a logie.
It's got me. I'm going.
Don't worry. I'll save you.
It's the angel.
Mother Nature's powers I now usurp. Drop my friends as I make you.
Angel. Angel, you saved our lives.
It was nothing. Besides, that plant's on a diet. You naughty plant. I told you not to eat between pygmies.
Angel, how can we thank you?
Well, you could let me sing my little song.
Oh no.
I left my harp in San Francisco.
Angel, I think Mr. Big is calling.
Oh, I'd better go then.
Thank goodness she's gone.
Oh, I dropped my harp.
What's that I hear?
I think it's jungle drums.
No, it's a herd of stampeding elephants. Look.
No! Ossie, what can we do? We're trapped in this clearing in the path of a herd of stampeding elephants.
This is it, old pal. The end is near. There's no escape.
What a way to go. Just a minute. What was that?
It's Fred Fly.
Fred Fly, superbug extraordinaire? Hello, Fred. Is that so? Do you really think you can do it?
Yes, I do.
He's going to meet the charging elephants head on.
No.
Yes.
Wow.
What do you mean, a telephone exchange swipe?
He's reversed the charges!
You've done it! You've done it, Fred! You've saved us! Hooray for Fred Fly!
Hooray! Hooray! What a fly! You beauty!
Thank you, Fred! Ozzie, we must press on. The jungle is thick and we have a long way to go.
Hey, Darrel, look. We're knee-deep in pigments.
Goodness, so we are. They're only about 2 feet tall.
Yes. Look at their little darts. Oh, there's one of them now.
And look, here comes a 6-foot native. He might be their chief.
He's sure to be if he has 6 feet.
Look at those muscles. What a fine figure of a man.
Wow.
Just a second. He's coming our way. Hello, chief.
Hello there. I'm the chief of the pygmies.
But You're 6 feet tall.
6'6" in my high heels. Yes, I'm the tallest pygmy in the world.
Tallest pygmy in the world? Come on now, Chief. I think that's stretching things a bit too far, don't you?
Pleased to meet you, Chief.
How nice. Speaking of meat, I've come to invite you for dinner.
Thank you very much. When will dinner be ready?
Just as soon as you are.
Hey, Daryl, wasn't it nice of the pygmies to give us a nice hot bath before dinner?
Ossie, I think they're cannibals.
You don't say. Hey, what are cannibals?
Natives like these who put people like us into pots like these and cook them.
Oh, I wondered why they put carrots and onions in my bath.
I'm afraid this is the end, Feathered Beaky. We've had it this time.
Yes, the little pygmies are licking their little lips.
And the water is getting hotter and hotter and hotter.
We're done for!
It's Charlie Who!
Ah, so, I have come to save you, Mr. Slummers and Mr. Ostrich.
But how, Charlie?
I bring takeaway order of Dimmy Simmy for the pygmies, and while they eating, we all get away!
What a good idea! Let's go! Right, here's the plane. Let's get aboard.
If I can't find a board, would a plank do?
Get onto the plane, you idiot. Here come the pygmies.
Ow!
Where did they get you, Charlie?
Oh, right in my dimmy simmy.
Ah, we've made it. Ossie, you'd better check in with base.
Okay. Hello, base. Jungle safari to base. We're on our way home. You can expect us at 6.
Wait, smouldering prop jets. One of our engines has fallen off.
Hello, base. Correction. One of our engines fell off. We'll be half an hour late getting home.
Another engine fell off.
Hello, base. We'll be an hour late getting in. Only 2 engines left.
Ah, there's 3 of them gone now, Mr. Slummers.
Hello, base. 3 engines have dropped off. We'll be an hour and a half late getting home.
It's gone. The only engine we had left has fallen off. You know what this means?
Sure. Hello, base. You might as well pack it in. We're going to be up here all night.
Job in a rock and roll band.
Well, bless my soul, rock and roll, flying purple people eater, pigeon toed undergrowth, flying purple people eater.
We mash on charts,
friendly little people eater. What a sight to see. And then he swung from the tree and he lit on the ground and he started to rock, really rocking around. It was a crazy ditty with a swinging tune.
Singing up, up, a loo, up, a lop, bam, boom.
Well, bless my soul.
That's the worst sound I've ever heard.
Really?
Have you had any musical training?
Yes, 10 years under Liberace.
Oh, he taught you music?
No, he lived in the flat upstairs.
Oh, look, if you're going to play like that, I'm leaving.
Well, that's all right with me. Let her rip, fellas.
That's it. What rubbish. I'll see you on the other side.
Oh, he really meant it. Hi, Daryl. Wait for me.
As our story begins, Little Red Riding Hood is tripping through the forest. What was that?
Little Red Riding Hood tripping.
Suddenly, deep in the forest, she met a woodsman.
It fell on his foot.
Red Riding Hood told the woodsman she was taking a basket of goodies to her sick grandma, and the woodsman warned her to watch out for the wolf.
Starting off in his E-type jade.
But he doesn't have it. Oh, never mind. Very soon, he stopped at Grandma's house. He stood outside the door, took a deep breath, and blew the door down. She heard the noise and said, "Who is it?" The wolf said,
"It's a wolf."
And he rushed in and pulled Grandma out of her bed. Oh, look, how can I tell you a story when you keep interrupting? Now, please be quiet. Mm-hmm. And then the wolf locked Grandma in the cupboard. Hang on, that's enough doors.
Sorry.
Then he jumped into Grandma's bed. I know.
It's a water bed.
Yes, yes. Just then, Little Red Riding Hood arrived and called for her grandma. The wolf said,
"Yes, my dear, come right into my room."
And there was the wolf, sitting up in bed, wearing Grandma's bonnet and shawl. Little Red Riding Hood said, "Grandma, what big ears you have."
"All the better to hear your sweet voice with, my dear."
And then she looked at his big nose. "Grandma, what a big nose you have."
"All the better to smell those tasty goodies with, my dear."
"What big teeth you have."
"All the better to eat you with, my dear, and the goodies in your basket."
As the wolf grabbed Little Red Riding Hood, the woodsman burst into the room. What's that?
The woodsman bursting.
Oh, look, will you behave yourself? Oh, I don't know. The wolf got such a fright when he saw the woodsman's big axe that he jumped out the window and the woodsman chased him off through the woods. Then Little Red Riding Hood and Grandma had a nice cup of tea and the wolf never bothered them again. I suppose you know why.
Oh, yes. He went straight on to the three little pigs job.
Look, you're impossible. Why can't I work with an elephant?
Oh, I'll get you one or two.
Stop. Look, that's enough. That's the bitter end. Look, I'm fed up with you, Ossie. You've messed everything up. You're a dummy, a beaked twit, and a feathered dunderhead.
You don't like me, I know. Well, I might as well go back to Africa and live with the other ostriches.
You don't
like me anymore.
Well, it's not that I don't. Well, look, we really love you. I mean, you know, but it's, you know what it's like. I mean,
you're only saying that.
No, I'm not just saying it. Look, I'm singing it. Listen.
We love you, Ozzie. Oh, yes, we do. We love you, Ozzie Ostrich. Oh, we're very fond of you.
We love you, Ozzie.
So does everyone. We
ostrich. Oh, we're very fond of you.
Oh, Daryl, I am deeply touched.
Oh, that's nice.
There's really only one thing left for me to say.
Yes, what's that?
Got any cherry?
I know you're going to laugh when you hear what I have to say, but it seems that things nowadays are too grown up, no time to play. But I love Mickey Mouse, and Donald Duck sure blows my mind, and a guy as smart as Elmer Fudd is very hard to find, very hard to find. When we were kids, the things we did to pass the time away were very simple games and golden books in a tray. Fairy tales and make-believe too quickly pass away and leave us with a cold reality. That's why I say I love Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck sure blows my mind, and the guy as smart as Elmer Fudd is very hard to find, very hard to find. I know that you have laughed, now you've heard what I've had to say, but it seems that things nowadays are too grown up, so let's all say I love Mickey Mouse, a Donald Duck sure blows my mind, and the guy as smart as Elmer Fudd is very hard to find, very hard to find.
Division Saturday. This episode, Will They or Won't They? We pick up our heroes, Detective Sergeant Spanner and Sergeant Peter's Ice Cream, on a routine patrol.
Hey, did you notice how fast that car was going?
Yes, we'd better drive alongside and have him pull over.
Right. Hey, pull over, driver! Not this way, stupid! I've a good mind to give him a ticket.
Don't do that. He might win something.
Oh.
We'd better buzz off anyway. The police will be here any minute.
Yes, sir. But we are the police.
See? What did I tell you?
Hello. Is that car 21 and a half?
Yes, yes. Are you Grotty of the base?
Oh, I certainly am. I've got a job for you. There's been a breakout at the prison.
Not measles again.
Yes, measles McGinty.
Tell us, Grotty, what does he look like?
Oh, he's about 7 feet tall, 5 feet wide, and he weighs all around about 25 stone.
And where does he usually go?
Anywhere he likes.
Okay, we're right onto it.
Hey, what have you stopped for?
Well, we can't go through this intersection. Look, there's a fire engine wanting to cross too. I don't know who has the right of way here.
Just a minute, then. I'll contact Grotty at the base. Hello, base.
Yes, can I help you?
Grotty, we have a problem. You'd better get the policeman's manual.
Hello, this is Manuel. Can I help you?
Manuel, we've got a problem.
Well, take 2 aspirin and go to bed and call me in the morning.
Not that sort of problem. At an intersection, which has the right of way, a fire engine or a police car?
That sounds like a 409. Why don't you fix it with a
Yes, I should have thought of that myself. I'll be right back.
I wonder what he's going to do.
Yes, I fixed it now. We can cross.
What did you do?
Well, you see, I nicked around behind the fire engine and lit a little fire. And now they're busy putting it out. Listen. Hello, Grotty, at the base? Can you tell us where to look for Measles McGinty?
Well, he sometimes hides out with his sister and her husband.
Is she Molly?
Most of the time.
Oh, well, in that case, that's Molly's house over there. Pull up.
I'll get out and check the place over.
Just a minute. Come back.
Yes?
You forgot your whistle.
Oh, I forgot to open the window, too. Here I go. Police here. Open up. Police here.
What do you mean by waking us up at this time of the night?
Ooh.
Me and my husband were asleep.
Yes. Go away, you nasty policeman, you, and take your whistle with you.
Just a minute. Have you seen your brother Measles?
No.
What a strange person.
Hey, hey, look. Look, there goes Measles McGinty over the back fence.
Don't worry. I'll go after him on foot.
Look at that sergeant run. Why, I've never seen anything like it. He's just behind McGinty now, and now he's past him, and he's streaking away in front, and he'll beat McGinty to the line by a short half head. Yes, he's got McGinty, and he's bringing him back to the car. Oh, congratulations. Mrs. McGinty must be scared of you.
I'll say. Otherwise, he wouldn't have a gun in me back.
You mean we're in his power?
Yes. He says we have to drive him to Broken Hill. Get in the back, Measles, please. And I'll get in the front. Okay, let's go. And drive as fast as you can.
I don't like it. I don't like it a bit. I was driving to Broken Hill with Measles McGinty in the back of the car.
Don't worry. Drive as fast as you can and we'll soon tire him out.
What do you mean, tire him out? How?
There's no floor in the back. He'll have to run all the way.
Will our heroes finally catch Measles, or are they due for another spot of trouble? Don't miss the next exciting episode of Division Saturday, a Crawfish production.
It was nice of you to take me for a drive in the country.
Oh, it's a pleasure, Oz. We're certainly a long way from home.
Yeah. Hey, why don't we turn on the car radio?
That's a good idea. In fact, we might even pick up a local radio station.
Yeah.
I'll just tune in. Yeah.
G'day, listeners. This is 2KW Uppercum Buck the West, playing you the latest on the charts up here in the country. You just heard Peter Dawson singing Songs Me Mother Taught Me, followed by Songs Me Mother Didn't Know Me Father Taught Me. And now... Moving right along. Shut that window, will you, Charlie? Thanks, mate. It was too drafty in here for Daisy the cow. You're all right, girl. Settle down now. Don't eat the breakfast, okay? And now, with the compliments of Dad's, the sheep dip that's a ripper of a dipper, we bring you the hits of the week. But first, this here advertisement.
Use Dad's sheep dip on your sheep while stacked on our flock. They'll stick to the fence, too. Try it yourself, and if you like it, try it on your sheep. Remember, Dad's takes the worry out of being close. And remember the slogan, Dad's sheep dip is good for yous. And what's good enough for yous is good enough for me.
Righto, now here's hit number 3 this week, our local dairy milkers group, the Cold Fingers, singing the Road to Gundagai.
There's a track winding back to an old fashioned track along the road to Gundagai, where the blue mountains are growing, the marron beach is flowing beneath that sunny sky. Where my daddy and mommy are waiting for me, and the pals of my childhood, one more I will see. Then no more will I roam when I'm heading right for home along the road to Gundagai.
There's a narrow and windy and bumpy and bushy old track, winding back to a rickety, rockety, tumble-down shack along the road to Gundagai. Where the biggest and brightest of all the blue gums are growing, and the lazy old river, the Marron Finch, is flowing beneath the sunny sky. Where my daddy and mommy are waiting for me, and the pals of my childhood once more. Along the road to Gundagai.
moving right along, it's time for Mrs. McGillicuddy with her CWA report. Thank you, Mrs. McGillicuddy. Mrs. Mac, wake up, love.
Hello, listeners. I'm very excited about the news I have for you today. The results of the Junior Sports Day. The long jump was won by little Jimmy Smith, who jumped 25 yards. He backed into a porcupine. The grand prize was Miss Featherstone's crocheted shawl, and it was carried off by the president of the Young Farmers Club, and so was Miss Featherstone. Now, I'll just close with my thought for the day. Here it is. The early bird gets the worm. So I want all you listeners to be early birds, and you'll all get worms. Thank you. I'll just pop off now. Goodbye.
Thank you, Mrs. Mac. Ahead of more music on 2KW, up a come back to West, here's number two on the charts, a real fast climber. Blimey, Teddy, not that fast. Yes, it's the Squawkin' Brothers with The Dog Sits on the Tuckerbox.
My maple waits for me underneath the bright blue sky, where the dog sits on the Tuckerbox, 5 miles from Gundagai. I meet her every day and I know she's dainty-dog, where the dog sits on the Tuckerbox, 5 miles from Gundagai. Oh, my Mabel waits for me underneath the bright blue sky, where the dog sits on the Tuckerbox, 5 miles from Gundagai. I think she's Bonja, and she reckons I'm Kudo. She's such a trimmer that I've entered her for the local Tuckerbox. My Mabel waits for me underneath the bright blue sky, where the dog sits on the Tuckerbox, 5 miles. Did I hear you say 5 miles? It's a very long way, 5 miles, on the road to Gundagai.
Yes, this is 2KW Upper Cumbuckta West Hit Parade, folks. I'd give you the time, but it's a cloudy day and our sundial isn't working. Now for the big one. Not you, Daisy. Sit down. It's Click Go the Shears. This little number has taken the country by storm. Not doing too well in the city, but killing them in the country. Just before we play it, though, we cross out to the all-night sheep-a-thon for a spot report. That was Spot. Now here's our reporter, Reginald Chumley Forsyth Jones, or as he's affectionately known around the station, Old Stinky. Over to you, Stinko.
Crummy station, really. I'm speaking to you from the Hickenwacker Shearing Sheds, and I want you to meet the head shearer, Mr. Dave Ostrich.
G'day, listeners.
Are you really the head shearer?
Yes. Would you like to meet the bloke who shears the other end?
What do you do most of your shearing?
Oh, just behind the ears, down around
no,
the back.
No. I mean whereabouts.
Oh, over there, behind that curtain.
But why do you shear behind a curtain?
Well, I shear sheep that don't like getting undressed in public.
Really?
But I'll have to get back to me farm, mate.
What?
Well, I've just heard that it's been washed out by a flood.
Goodness gracious,
mate. All me cattle have foot and mouth disease. Me wife and kids have run off with a circus. Me mum and dad are trapped up a tree by a mad bull. And me cousin Charlie is sinking into a quagmire of quicksand.
Oh, but surely you could give us a little song before you go?
Sorry, mate, but I don't know the words. Anyway, the shearing is all over and we've all got our checks.
But they are the words.
Really? Oh, well, let's swing into it then.
Shearing is all over and we've all got our checks. Roll up your swag, we're all in on the tracks. The first place we come to is there we'll have a spree. And everyone that comes along can come and drink with me.
Around and it's making
folks. Click Go the Shears, number one up here in Upper Cumbuckta West. Just before we close down, here's a reminder to all you motorists. It takes 25,000 nuts to put a car together, but only one to scatter them all over the road. Stone the crows! Here comes one of them now!
Look out, Daryl!
Too late!
Leaping black stumps! You'd be a couple of whackers!
What happened?
We just broke into radio!
Puff the magic dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Honolee. Little Jackie Paper loved that rascal Puff and brought him strings and sealing wax and other fancy stuff. Oh, Puff the magic dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Honolee. Puff the magic dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Honolee. Together they would travel on a boat with billowed sail. Jackie kept a lookout perched on Puff's gigantic tail. Noble kings and princes would bow whene'er they came. Pirate ships would lower their flags when Puff roared out his name. Oh, Puff the magic dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Honolee. Puff the magic dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Honolee. A dragon lives forever, but not so little boys. Painted wings and giant's rings make way for other toys. One gray night it happened, Jackie Paper came no more, and Puff that mighty dragon, he ceased his fearless roar. His head was bent in sorrow, green scales fell like rain. Puff no longer went to play along the cherry lane. Without his lifelong friend, Puff could not be brave. So Puff, that mighty dragon, sadly slipped into his cave. Oh, Puff, the magic dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Honolee. Puff, the magic dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Honolee.
Just a quick thought for anyone who may have received this album as a birthday present.
If we hurry, we might just be able to fit this in.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, everybody. Happy birthday.